Hello, good evening, and here we are yet again for another lovely session of CENG 4412 Steel and Concrete Design. Okay, in this video we are going to move on to a new topic, and that is steel beams. Okay, so we finished up looking at shear and concrete beams. So we've looked at the bending moment capacity and shear capacity of concrete beams, of reinforced concrete beams, and now we're moving on to discussing bending or flexure in steel beams. Okay, so in this video I want to have a few objectives. First, I wish to review names for beams and related elements in terms of member sizes, etc. Describe the flexural response leading up to ultimate beam capacity, and define plastic moment. Okay, so let's get started here and do that thing I said. Okay, so let's begin. Now, let's do a bit of review. So this may be a bit of a review, hopefully. This is a review from earlier courses, maybe a bit mentioned in this course here at various places along the way. But first, I just like to go through a bit of naming convention. Okay, so first of all, to do this, I'm gonna lay out the basic generic floor framing plan. So let's do that here. So if I look at a floor framing plan, and this would be a floor framing plan, and what I mean by this would be a basic, steel frame structure in a plan view, rather than, say, elevation view. Okay, so let's say I have a couple columns, and maybe I'll draw them as W shapes, W sections, something like this, and something like this, a couple columns here. And something like this, I'll just draw a single bay here. And then maybe something like this here. Okay, and maybe I'll draw that a little down to the right more, or down and to the right more. And that'll do it. Okay, next, let me show some girders. I'm gonna show a couple lines here and discuss and review the definition or the distinction between beams and girders. Here and here. Something like this, and maybe then I have something. So this would be girders here in green, and then I have beams that I'll draw maybe in, red or something. Maybe a nice dark red, like that. Almost a maroon, reliving my A&M days. All right, so then this will be beams here. Something like this. And beams here. So let's review the definition of each of these. Beams, of course, directly gather area load. Or primarily exist to directly gather area load. Exist to gather area loads. So in other words, if you have you would have tributary areas, and each of these beams would be supporting a small area, a tributary area. For example, this beam would be supporting area from here to here, center line, basically halfway from the center line. Now, as I have this drawn, this would be a one-way loading arrangement where I don't have beams going in two directions, just beams in one direction. Now, again, let me describe girders, then I'll describe how this is only in general, not completely. There are some exceptions, of course. Then girders. Girders are going to generally, or primarily, gather up the, girders primarily support beams. They primarily exist to support beams. Let me put the word exist in there. Primarily exist to support beams. Girders are going to primarily exist to support beams. Okay, So let's think about this then. And let me say, okay, there are of course going to be some exceptions to this. So you can find, we can find some. We can well, girders generally going to be anything that supports a beam, but and generally beams are going to support area loads. However, often, especially if we have two-way loading, girders will also be supporting a small amount of area load. And there may be times where individual beams will carry some large point loads. If I had like a heavy piece of equipment here, something like that. Or I could have something that I consider a beam, but maybe I had some like very small, really small secondary beams or tertiary beams, that kind of thing. And so maybe then my beams would be supporting beams as well. But as a general rule, a girder is a much heavier structural element with a much longer span, and it's existing primarily to support beams. So generally, so beams will generally have a much will be much smaller, much lighter. They'll have a much shallower depth than your heavier girders will. Then let me show in general what the not shear moment diagrams, but maybe what the load diagrams for shear for not for shear for beams and girders would look like. So let's look at this in terms of beam versus girder. Beam versus girder load diagram, in case it's not apparent. So here, for beams first, let me be consistent with what I had before. I was using dark red there, so I'll use dark red here. So for beams, we would generally have load diagrams something like this. Let me show one for maybe one-way loading and then another for two-way loading. Again, two-way loading is if I have beams going in more than one direction and I'm distributing. So again, if a two-way loading would be if I had a set of beams going in this direction, and then I would be dividing load up based on, say, 45-degree angles, trapezoids, that kind of thing. But I'll draw out some typical load diagrams or general shapes for both one-way and two-way loading. So for beams, and I'll just draw these as simply supported. Of course, both beams and girders could be simply supported or fixed supported or some combination of the two, but I'll just keep things relatively simple and draw these as simply supported members. So now we'll describe things as beam. Now, so for when we go forward, when I talk about flexure, I'm going to refer to things as beams. So for example, when I go forward and talk about different types of shapes, or when we go forward looking at chapter F and looking at flexure in general, I'm not going to use the word girder a lot. I'm just going to use the word beams in general. So when I talk about later on, when I say design of beams, I'm talking about all whether I'm talk I'm kind of lumping beams and girders together. But in actual parlance, the technical definition, there are differences between beams and girders. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. For one-way loading. My load diagram for beams would look something like this. It might just look like a, actually, it might even just be as simple as a uniform line load all the way across the top. Something like that. Then for two-way loading, it'd be a little bit more complex. And I'll again draw a simply supported beam. If I can manage to draw a beam in a straight line. Two-way loading would be something more like this. And it could be trapezoidal, it could be a triangle. If the grid of beams was laid out such that it was equally spaced between, like in other words, the grid was just as wide as it is tall or wide as it is long, then it would be a triangular loading. But otherwise, more often you might end up with more of a trapezoidal loading. Something kind of like this. Dividing things up into tributary areas. Next semester, I'm hoping to put together some a video series on structural analysis, and hopefully, I'll be able to get some nice videos really going into this in more depth. But we'll see. That's my planned project for next semester. This semester, each semester as I'm teaching, I try to create or do some videos on a given course, and I can't do them for all my courses in each semester just because of the time commitment involved. But each semester I kind of pick one course or one or two courses and try to make a video series on it. But anyway, this semester it's steel and concrete. Next semester I'm hoping to do structural analysis. But anyway, so we have beams. This is what some generic loading diagrams look like for beams. And next, let's consider girders. So the real defining feature of the load diagrams for girders is going to be the large point loads coming down from the beam loads. So again, look here. Now this particular beam here, it's directly being supported by the columns, but these beams here, they are being supported by connections on the girders. So this girder here would be supporting these large girders here, would be supporting point loads from the end reactions of the beams here. Okay, next let's look at girders. All right, and I'll draw again two simply supported girders here. And let's see. And you may have noticed I kind of almost said beam diagrams there. And again, this is kind of because when we're talking flexure, often I don't want to do that. I don't want two rulers. When we're talking flexure, often we just refer to anything in flexure as a beam. For example, when we look at combined loading, we'll talk about beam columns. But when we're talking purely about loading, anything in flexure generically can be referred to as a beam, but we do actually have a difference in definition between a beam and a girder. And also, I will give an alternate classification system that you sometimes see as well, but let me just lay this out here. So girders, I should probably label these also one-way and two-way loading. One-way loading. And two-way loading. One-way loading and two-way loading. Then for my girders here, if it was one-way loading, my girders would mainly be supporting just the point loads. Just the point loads of the beams here. So as I've drawn this, this is one-way loading, and I'm assuming that the beams are essentially going to be carrying all of the distributed area loads. So I would have the floor slab just directly bearing on the top of the beams here, and the girders might actually even be below the level of the beams or something. That would be a bit unusual, but or maybe how we just have them designed. That's how we could design a connection such that that's how the load would primarily be distributed, or maybe that's just what we're assuming in terms of tributary area and load. We'll just assume or design for load to distribute around the structure. But then in two-way loading, I would assume that there would be some sort of, if I have two-way loading where I had a set of girders going this way as well, I would then assume that there would be some, I would have to assume that the girders here would take a triangular tributary area as well. So it would be more like I have my large point loads coming down, and then I would have sort of a series of triangular loads kind of like this, laid out something in this fashion here. A little bit, I know this is a little bit rough, kind of squeezing this in. But if you had more of a if you had more of a two-way loading, you would end up with something kind of like this. Kind of like this here. Okay. Next, let me talk about, there is an alternate way of classifying these that you do see in certain circumstances. Alternate classification. Alternate classification. Now, in this class, I am going to refer to a more traditional beam and girder approach, or maybe not traditional, but a more, at least in my experience, it's a more conventional beam and girder approach. But sometimes you do hear an alternate classification system. So sometimes what you hear, instead of beam and girder using the same definitions, sometimes you hear beam and girder. But other times you hear an approach referring to these as joist and beam. So it would depend on the type of flooring system you have. Now, when I think of a joist, I tend to think of light flooring trusses, that kind of thing. You tend to hear joist when you're talking about very light flooring trusses. So for example, if you have a, you know, prefabricated flooring joist system, especially in like a home construction and things like that, residential, so you might have, you know, you might have, or in light, or just in general steel frame buildings, sometimes instead of beams and girders, both made of say W sections, you might have something like this, where you have a prefabricated truss. You know, something, oh, how can I draw this? I'll just draw a very basic truss. You know, something like this. Very basic truss. Just trying to sketch a truss really quickly here. And then this would be supported by maybe some sort of W section. Something like this. I know this is a very poor detail. This, do not try to build this. You'll have a bad day. But something like this. You would definitely need a different connection. That's a very bad connection design. Do not try to do this. You're going to kill somebody. Anyway, basic idea. So you would have a joist that would be some, often be some sort of truss, and then a beam supporting the truss. And then often you'd have maybe some sort of decking, like a prefabricated metal decking, Volcraft, something like that. So you'd have some sort of decking, you know, this kind of, when I say decking, I mean something that has kind of a shape like this, prefabricated metal, prefabricated steel decking. And this would be not literally just laying on top of it, it would be properly, oh man, I ruined everything forever. Okay, let me draw this in a series of lines instead of one, so I don't have to erase the whole thing if I screw up. So this would be laying on top of it, not just literally laying on top of it, it would be properly tied down to this, welded down to it, etc. That kind of thing. Although you can also use decking directly with a more conventional beam and girder like we talked about previously. Something like this. Looks something like this. And then you lay down your, you can lay down your joist system, then you can lay down your decking, or you could use beams and decking. And then you simply pour concrete over the top of this. But if also another way to do this is to use beams and girders, but then have the decking, have studs sticking through the decking into the beams welded to them, and then you have a, you sort of use a composite action, composite beam action, where you're actually using the floor slab as part of a concrete beam effectively. But anyway, that may be a bit beyond the scope of this course. Okay. So anyway, let's talk about this here. Now, this is, so let's move on. That's the basic idea of beams versus girders. As you can see, even here, flooring systems and support systems can get quite complex. And previously, mainly I'm going to be talking about what I laid out. Well, normally when I talk about beams and girders, I'll be using this kind of definition here. But there are other flooring systems available. There are other ways of classifying things, etc. But in terms of how the code treats it, like I've mentioned previously, flexural design in terms of code, or the AISC manual, it splits it up a little bit differently. Flexural members AISC, it's going to split things up a little bit differently. So it, again, the authors of the AISC might not disagree, not necessarily disagree with this whole beam and girder classification, they'd probably agree. Chapter F refers to simply refers to beams. And basically for Chapter F, when we talk about beams, in the code, when it talks about a beam, well, it's going to refer to, when the code uses the word beam, they're basically referring to any off-the-shelf steel shape that you're using as a flexural member. Any off-the-shelf. So if you see the word beam in the AISC manual, they're referring to any off-the-shelf, any kind of standard shape, any off-the-shelf shape that you are using as a flexural member, that you are using to support bending load. Flexural member, any off-the-shelf shape, whether it could be, that could be a W shape, it could be a C channel, it could be an angle iron, although that wouldn't necessarily be ideal, but it can be any off-the-shelf shape that you are using as a flexural member. However, and then they don't necessarily specifically define girders, but they do define plate girders. And you can also have beams that are, you could make girders, you could build up girders or build up beams that are small, but it would still be, that would not necessarily be off the shelf, but would still be classified as beams here. But, or in general, I should say, any shape without a very slender web. And I will provide some guidance on this. Without a very slender web. Oh, let me get back here. A slender web. And then they also define plate girders. And plate girders are things that have very slender webs. And often they're referred to as plate girders because they're often not even hot rolled shapes, like the kind of shapes we usually talk about, very slender webs. So when I say plate girders, I literally mean girders made out of plate. So if I want to make a plate girder, often what I'll do is I will literally take big pieces of plate and weld them together. And sometimes this is done on site, but oftentimes, if possible, this will be done in a fab shop. And it would be preferable to do in a fab shop if you can possibly manage it, because then you can have, say, like our big robot welded up if possible. You get nice consistent welding, et cetera, et cetera. If there's any way to weld something up in a shop, it's going to be preferable to welding it in the field, but sometimes you can't avoid field fabrication of this stuff. Okay, let's go back here. So you would literally use three big pieces of plate, you know, whatever plate you have available, whatever plate you need, a half inch, a three quarter inch, even inch or higher, a plate, and you're literally manufacturing your own I-beam, or your own W section in that regard. And so, again, W shapes, your typical shapes that we're going to use in this class are hot rolled shapes. They're shapes that are forged, they're shapes that are, not. I shouldn't say forged, they're shapes that are rolled in a manufacturing facility, in a hot rolling facility, in the manner that we previously discussed. In plate girders, you are actually going to buy just big steel plate, and you're gonna, you know, big long lengths of steel plate, you're gonna cut it to whatever size you need, and you are literally going to weld it together. Hot rolled shapes are not welded. They're not separate plates. It's if you go and buy a W36 or something like that, it's not like somebody at some point, you know, had a flange plate, a web plate, two flange plates and a web plate and just welded them together. They are one continuous member. They are literally passed through rollers and rolled at very high temperatures into whatever shape they need. Plate girders are the opposite. So the thing about hot rolled shapes is they're great, they're efficient, but they're limited in what kinds of depths you want. If you need some like crazy deep beam, if you need an 8 foot deep beam or something like that, if you need some crazy huge beam that you're gonna use for some really long, crazy long steel bridge span, or if you're, I don't know, what I think of is maybe like some crazy long span for a really long bridge, or like a, I don't know, the what comes to mind is like a major structural beam for like a, now you tend to use a truss for this, but I don't know, like a really long beam for like a football stadium or something really cool like that. Or a beam a long span beam that had to carry a really heavy load, like a railroad bridge or something like that. You can't really use hot rolled shapes for that. You need something that's a really, really deep beam. You often need things like web stiffeners and all sorts of exotic things. Well, exotic in the context of this class anyway. And you can't really just go and buy an off-the-shelf hot rolled shape for that. So instead, you're going to build your own shape. You're going to make a custom shape. If you need a 10-foot deep beam, you're not going to be able to get that or even necessarily transport that to practically. So yeah, I mean, think about that. Imagine if you needed some insanely deep beam, like if you needed a 12-foot deep beam or something. Imagine if you needed a 12-foot deep, you know, 200-foot long beam or something really crazy like that. How would you even possibly transport that? I mean, maybe you could if you closed down a bunch of roads or something, but you're probably just going to manufacture that on site and then use a giant crane to just lift that. You're going to lift that to wherever you need it on in the building or the structure. You're going to make it on the dirt, you know, literally in the dirt on the at the construction site. You're just going to bring in a bunch of steel plate, weld it together in the rain, and make whatever you need on site, and then lift it into place where you need it. So anyway, I'm kind of getting carried away here, but that's the basic idea of the plate girder. And so that's the basic idea of the plate girder. But the code distinction here, when you can analyze something as a beam, a simple beam, and when you can analyze something as a plate girder, is based on the ratio of the H to the height of the web to the thickness. Where H over TW is less than or equal to 970 divided by the square root of FY, with FY in kips per square inch KSI. So you do need to use the correct, units here. That should be FY in KSI here, not PSI, but KSI. The concrete manual is going to use PSI for things. The steel manual is going to tend to use KSI for things. And HRTW, if you need a review. And I'm going to reference the, I am going to reference the 15th edition of the manual, just like I have been in the other videos here. And you can see this here. H is referring to, well, D is referring to the entire depth of a beam. H is simply the height of only the web of the beam. So if you have a beam, at least for a plate girder here, H would be the not necessarily the clear distance between the fillets, but just the distance from one flange to the next. This is your H here. H is here, and depth D is here. H and D. Okay? And this would be your thickness of the web. So the AISC manual says, the thickness of the web, TW, the AISC manual says that if your H over TW is less than 970, then you're going to be in the form of a, you can use chapter F, the beam design chapter. If H over TW is less than 970 over this, then you are a plate girder, or sorry, then you can use chapter F. Apply chapter F convention regular beam analysis. Regular beam analysis. Otherwise, it's a plate girder. You have a plate girder. You have a plate girder, and must use different sections of the manual. A plate girder. Now, again, plate girders are going to be in a different section of the manual. Chapter F is where we're primarily going to see conventional beam design. Now, though, plate girders are rather difficult to design. There are all sorts of special failure modes that you need to consider. You need to start considering things like shear failure becomes more prominent. You actually need to worry more about the web buckling. You often have to start adding things like plate girders. Let me just give notes on some of the problems of these plate girders. You have to worry about things like, more shear failure is more critical. We will learn to calculate shear for our regular beams, but for plate girders, shear is often more critical, and you have to check it more carefully. We will learn how to check it in our beam design here, but it's usually so, for almost all of the standard shapes in the AISC manual, shear will not control, but we'll still check it anyway, just to be sure. You also have to worry, start worrying about things like, you have to worry a little bit about this, but you have to worry about, especially with plate girders, of things like the web buckling like a column. And you often need to design web stiffeners. And if you want to see these, if you want to see examples of web stiffeners, you can. The easiest way, they're the most often placed, the place that I see them the most, at least, you know, that aren't embedded within some roof system that you can't see in a building or something. Even though I rarely see roof systems in buildings, but the place I see them the most, again, is in railroad bridges. So railroad bridges are a great example of plate girders that you can. Now you can often see them in other heavy industrial things, but in terms of the place that people are most able to have easy access to them, please don't go climbing on railroad property. I mean, just seeing them from the road, driving by or on the sidewalk, etc. Please don't trespass on railroad property and then blame it on me. Anyway, but you often see these big railroad bridges with big, huge built-up plate girders. These big things like this, and you'll see these really thick, really tall girders, and they'd be, actually, the, you know what, I probably don't like this, I want to draw this even taller, just to really illustrate the idea of how tall these things are. They're really big, and I'm not going to have enough room to draw the width of these, the proper length of these things, or the proper span. They would tend to have a much longer span than this. Well, I probably shouldn't need to tell you, but trains tend to be heavy. You learn the most useful things in this class. You learn that trains are heavy, but obviously trains are, well, indeed quite heavy, and the tires, or not tires, the wheels on trains generate enormous point loads, enormous very heavy loads, big vibration, that kind of thing, and so the loads that railroad bridges need to carry are just way, 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 way beyond what a automobile bridge needs to carry, a car bridge needs to carry for at least for the same span anyway. And so you'd have your flange and web like this. But what you often see is these other things. So this would be continuing on. This is not just stopping here. This would continue on past this direction and continue on past this direction. So maybe make this like five times as long. You might have a four or five times as long, maybe three times. But definitely four or five times as long, and you might have a good diagram of a typical railroad bridge. And but the unique thing about it, the one thing that always stands out to my eye, is the web stiffeners. And these are secondary plates that are then welded in to these things. And again, these are true plate girders. They're actually made from plate, and you can tell, you can see them, you can recognize them from afar by looking for these web stiffeners. And these are elements that are literally secondary plates, so that if you have your, you know, if you look at it from the side or from a cross-sectional view, if you had your, let me just finish drawing these, here, if you look at these from across, this is again looking at from the side, then I'll draw the cross-section here. We're adding stiffeners, essentially, and basically what these do is they prevent buckling of the web. Just like a column, and we'll look at column design in the next unit after we finish with lecture, but just like columns can buckle, and you may remember that from mechanics, materials, structural analysis, etc. Just like columns can buckle, if you have a very tall, narrow flange, or sorry, very tall, narrow web, your web can actually buckle like a column. But so your plate girder might look something like this, with your flange plates and your web plates, like here. Although the flanges would probably be wider. I'm kind of simplifying here. I'm trying to cram it in here. And so you have your web plate, and then your flange plates, and then you would actually add secondary plates like this. They'd be the same color, obviously the same material, but I would add secondary plates periodically to sort of beef up the buckling resistance of the web. These wouldn't actually contribute... These really contribute almost nothing to the bending capacity of the member, but they would greatly increase its shear capacity and, more importantly, the ability to resist buckling. And I cannot draw a straight line to save my life today. Okay, so let's draw this. Perfectly straight line. Hopefully the person cutting your steel can cut a more straight line than I can draw. Okay, but anyway, so the point being, plate girders are complicated. Usually when I've seen it taught in courses, taught in engineering courses, civil engineering courses, I almost tend to see them, I tend to most often see them at the graduate level. When I learned to design them, I took them at a, I had that as part of my, I didn't learn how to design plate girders when I was in my, was I, when I was taking my undergrad degree. I learned to design them when I was taking a advanced steel design class at the graduate level. So you tend not to always see those at the undergraduate level, and this course is no exception. So we're not gonna, I do want to expose this to you as a topic to be aware of, and to be aware of that there are, just like, as I mentioned before, there are many, many topics in steel design and concrete design that we're not gonna have the time to get to. This is pretty much just, this is a survey course, and we are just covering the basis, the very basics of steel and concrete design. And so, but this is something it should, that you should be aware of. It can be nice to be aware of. The actual design of plate girders is something that it takes a long time to describe. And so, it would probably, it would take as much time to describe how to design plate girders as it would for me to design, to describe, just beam design in general. So, we're going to keep things simple and stay with chapter F for this class. So beams for this class are going to be consist only of those that chapter F is relevant to. So beams. We are going to be in chapter F of the steel manual. Chapter F of the steel manual. And we have a couple of things to be aware of in terms of failure modes. And we'll be exploring these as we go forward through the next couple lectures. The failure modes to be aware of are, well, first, we can have fully plastic failure. And we'll explore that later on tonight, what this means. So now I'm not going to be looking very much at the code, more just at the theory therein. Fully plastic, also, later we'll learn about something, not tonight, but something later. Lateral torsional buckling. Then we'll learn about local buckling. We take care of this more through geometry requirements. And shear. So these are the failure modes we need to be concerned with. So this may remind you of where we looked at, say, this may remind you of how we looked at, remember when we looked at tension members, steel tension members, we talked about all of the different ways tension members could fail. And this is really the same type of thing. We have a, just like tension members, we have a variety of ways that, flexural members can fail. And at least in terms of chapter F, or in terms of this class, what we're going to be concerned about, the failure modes we're going to be considering are fully plastic failure, lateral torsional buckling, local buckling, and shear. Okay. So here, and let's see here. And I think I'm actually going to stop this video here. I think that'll be a nice introduction to the basic definitions of beams and beams, columns, joists, chapter F, plate girders versus beams, etc. I think that'll be a logical breaking point for this video. Okay, I think I'll divide this lecture up into a couple different videos. Okay, that'll do it for now, and as always, thank you.